Hey everyone, Rory here, and in today's video, we're going to talk about how you can reduce the chance of being injured while doing jiu-jitsu. So whether you're brand new to Brazilian jiu-jitsu, you have been doing jiu-jitsu for a while and you've been injured in the past, or you haven't even started jiu-jitsu yet, but you're interested in trying it, then you want to know how to reduce the chance of being injured. Now, jiu-jitsu, Brazilian jiu-jitsu, is a combative sport. With live resistance is what makes it such a special martial art. And that does mean that there is a risk of getting injured. You have to accept the fact that you probably will be injured at some point in your life while training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Now, I've been training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for close to 12 years at this point, and I have not had any significant injury that has taken me out for more than a couple weeks at a time. In fact, the worst instance of me having to take some time off was me kinking my neck while just sleeping wrong, and it completely screwed me up for a couple weeks. I have had minor sprains and stuff like that, like in my knee or ankle, or dealing with tendonitis in my elbows, but any of those things, I can only take a couple days off, or I can train around it. But let's talk about how do we actually reduce the chance of being injured. Tip number one is we're looking at warming up. And now I don't mean doing like bullshit shrimps to the end of the mat or practicing your front somersaults to one end and back. I'm talking about warming up properly. When we're looking at warm-ups, we're looking at active warm-ups and passive warm-ups. So active warm-ups are what we're more used to in the sense that you are gonna be burning energy by contracting your muscles. So this can be doing those bullshit warm-ups at the beginning of class, which do have the purpose of warming you up and reducing the chance of injury. But I think that those should be more reserved to before class takes place. You are paying someone to teach you Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and I hate when a class is 1 hour long and 10 minutes of that class is wasted doing those warm-ups. If you have the ability to do so, get to class a little bit before it starts, whether there's a class going on before that, or hopefully your instructor shows up 10 to 15 minutes earlier before class is started, so you're able to get on the mats and actually do some movement. That could be doing those actual like exercises. It can be you even practicing actual techniques. For me, I like doing a little bit of yoga flows and starting to just get some stretches going on once my muscles have warmed up a bit, especially the problem areas where I know this my body quite well and I know what joints need a little bit of extra work before I actually get to training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. However, there's also passive warm-up, and that's where you're using external devices, essentially, to be able to do that. So even just by having your body temperature raised, you are reducing the chance of being injured. And so having a bath or a shower or a sauna or a hot tub before you get in, I mean, even cranking the heat in your car, depending on how hot you can get your car on like a winter day, that's going to get you better prep. There's times where I am not a morning person, and getting motivated enough to even eat a good breakfast before going and training, it just doesn't usually happen for me. So I just make sure I have a hot shower, I put on sweatpants, I put on a sweater, I get in my car, I crank the heat to keep my body temperature up as I get to the gym, and then I'm able to just get straight into a little bit of light like movement around, stretching, yoga flows. And I feel so much more limber than when I get on the mats, and you guys have probably all been there depending on where you live, where you can't even feel your toes because it's cold and stepping onto the cold mats. At that point, your body temperature is lower and you're more likely to injure certain parts of your body. Just by raising your body temperature, that can make a little bit of a difference to make sure that you're less likely to get injured. Tip number two is start slow. So in this circumstance where you might not be able to get to the gym before class starts, maybe you just got off work, maybe you don't actually have the ability to get on the mats and to be able to do a little bit of a warm up first, you gotta start slow. And so how we handle classes at Island Top Team is we don't do any of that warm up bullshit. You guys have hopefully warmed up the best you can, but we're gonna teach the technique, you're gonna learn it, and then you're gonna slowly drill it. And so none of the movements should be like this, especially an opening technique, shouldn't be some crazy flexible technique. It's not something we believe in anyway. But if you're learning a guard retention movement, like say the high leg slash high pummel, then you're going to start that very slowly and with little resistance. Your partner is gonna just do those movements off to the side, whether outside passing like leg drags, and you're gonna perform that high leg, and you're gonna do it slowly over and over again, and then you just slowly ramp that up, and that's how you're going to raise your body temperature and you're gonna warm your muscles up. Then by the midpoint of the class, you're probably going at a harder pace with it. And then obviously by the end of the class, you're looking at actually doing some positional sparring, actually like pressure testing this stuff and getting into the rolling after. Do not be that person that jumps into rolling with no warm up. And that's something that's more likely to happen at say an open mat. Until you're a certain level, do not just jump straight into rolling, because we've all been there where it's like, hey man, let's have a warm-up round. Let's roll light. And then the round just starts to get out of control and everybody's going way too hard. There was a time when I was visiting another gym and I had a blue belt come up to me and say, hey, you wanna do a nice light round just to warm up? I was like, yeah man, let's do it. We bumped fists and he was passing my guard and he tried to do some bullshit jumping pass. I can't remember if it was like a cartwheel with no hands, and he just ended up landing on his neck and head immediately and jacking himself up, and he had to sit out for the rest of the day. He was just done training at that point. It was like, what the hell are you doing? We just said warm-up round, we're gonna go light, and this guy just jumps and dies basically. Until you're a certain technical level, do not trust people to go light. Try and just do some drilling first, even if it's like an open mat or positional sparring with some sort of restrictions. The F your jiu-jitsu frames and levers sweeping or passing, like I've talked about in a previous video, stuff that kind of puts a restriction on each partner to kind of allow them a little bit more control over themselves, as well as an understanding that this isn't like about winning. It's about learning. It's about warming up slowly. Third tip is tap early and tap often. I do not make too many mistakes in the sense of breaking my alignment in some sort of way where I'm going to be trying to drive off with my structure, my leg in a compromised position that then ends up popping my knee or having my back twisted in some awful way that as my body can still generate force, I'm more likely to hurt myself. So one way that I get injured is from my partner. Now, sometimes that's accidents, like just getting hit in the face or something like that. I had to go to the hospital for stitches and stuff before. That's the stuff that's going to be inevitable within Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. It will happen. Even against brown belts and black belts, that stuff will still happen. However, you can control yourself when it comes to how early you tap to stuff. Honestly, like the biggest injuries I've had over the last like 6 years as I've progressed to higher ranks in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is just me being a dumbass and not tapping in time. Me sitting in an armbar too long, me sitting in a heel hook too long. And because my instructor, Rob Bernacki, and I can have really aggressive rounds and we go really toe to toe, there's times where it gets a little competitive and there's times where he's got me in something and I'm just like, nah, I'm good, I'm gonna keep going. And I hurt myself. And especially in a training environment, like who gives a shit? That's something that you just gotta learn to let go. You screwed up and it's great to have like that competitive atmosphere and that camaraderie of challenging each other, but you gotta look out after your safety, because if I get hurt, then I'm not getting better. And then that's also gonna hurt my training partners because they're not gonna have me to keep training with. Now, when you're first starting out, you're not gonna know what the heck to tap to. So it's a good idea to tap all the time. Anytime you start to feel pain, even discomfort, where if your arm's getting pulled and extended in some way and you don't know the technique, tap, talk to your training partner, see what they were trying to accomplish there. Was it too early for you to tap? Was there even actually a threat? Hopefully you have a training partner that is going to be able to explain that to you. And if they are still a white belt or a blue belt that's not comfortable talking to you about that at all, then call the instructor over and just check to see if there was something going on. There'll be times that you might tap something like pressure or something like that where it's not really a real threat and it's just really uncomfortable, but you'll get used to that in time about what is safe and what can you just absorb, what is just going to be pain rather than something that actually causes you harm. But you can go late into submissions the more and more comfortable you get with that stuff, but you gotta be super careful about that and you gotta make sure that you're tapping early with that. Competition is a different thing, but that is still something that I don't recommend unless you're like an ADCC, in which obviously you're very capable of understanding how to not hurt yourself and you don't need this video, then you can put a little more on the line. You can put a little more on the line of that gold medal match of worlds, but for most competitions, you wanna be able to get back to training that next day and working on the mistakes that you possibly made and working on how you can tighten up your game. Do not get hurt and put yourself out of the game for weeks or even months just because you want that reward of winning. Next tip is being selective of your training partners. Now, this isn't something that necessarily applies to everybody, but there are gonna be people at your gym that are either significantly bigger and stronger than you, or just much younger and more explosive, or especially when we're looking at spazzy white belts, you're just going, I'm gonna potentially get hurt training with that person. Now, there is definitely something good about training with spazzy white belts and even blue belts and being able to learn how to control them and be able to dominate them. And it's gonna help them as well with their journey of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, but that can be left up to somebody else. There's gonna be always enough people in the gym, especially the young men that are blue belts, and I think that they're just hot shit and they're gonna wanna roll with everybody, and that's fantastic. They can be that person's training partner if they need to, but there'll even be times for myself that whether I am recovering an injury or like a slight injury or something just felt kind of off with me that day, there's times, as we'll talk about, where it's like there wasn't proper nutrition or even sleep, and I'm just not feeling it. And I got a guy who's like a 220 pound professional rugby player who is a pretty skilled blue belt, and I'm going, you know what, maybe I don't roll with this guy today because this is going to be a handful, and this is going to put that little extra force on my knee potentially in a situation, because I know he's going to bring it, and it's always a good roll. I love rolling with him when I have myself feeling healthy. We got to be careful to make sure that we're not just going to be dodging people, that we're going to be taking the easy way out every day, because there's nothing wrong with losing. You want to go out there, and so I'm not saying don't go out there and even have like a more passive round, or you're going to work on certain things. You work around the injuries or how you feel, but sometimes it's better to choose a training partner and avoid certain people, and I recommend being more upfront with that. So whether it's somebody that is just being a dick and you don't want to train with them, or it's somebody where it's like, hey man, like, you got 100 pounds on me and I'm just not ready for this right now, or I'm not feeling really great today, and so either they can try and tone that back and go a bit lighter for you, that would be great, or it's just not gonna happen today. We're not gonna roll today, but I'd love to roll with you later this week or next week or whenever I feel better. Have that conversation. Don't necessarily just try to avoid somebody, and especially for long periods of time without having that conversation with somebody, because you could look like a bit of a dick without giving that explanation first. And especially, like, this is the thing that you hear the most for older practitioners. If you're in your 60s or 70s even, I've trained with people in their 70s, you gotta be more selective. You're not gonna bounce back the same way you would from injuries. And so you don't want to necessarily be rolling with that young 20-year-old white belt who's just always going hard in the gym. And everyone's gonna be understanding about that. If he comes up and he wants to try and roll with you, well, then you just once again explain the situation. And worst case scenario, you might hurt somebody's feelings, but if you do it politely, I think that can be avoided. But ultimately, it's your safety, and sometimes you're going to be in some awkward situations, but if they're not someone that you're comfortable training with, then it's not going to be that much of a loss anyway, and hopefully they will come around and understand where you're coming from. Next tip is lift weights, work out in whatever kind of way, any way that you can build strength and build a more resilient body, that is going to make you stronger. So this can be obviously from a rehab perspective where you have injured yourself and you need to take care of that body part, like your knee, and you're going to do some stuff that helps strengthen your leg and everything around the knee so that it's going to be more robust and that you feel back to as close to 100% as you can, but also from a prehab perspective, if you can work out and make yourself stronger, if you can stretch and make yourself more flexible, then that's just going to mean that you can bend that much further before you have a full grown human being trying to bend you forcefully in whatever direction that is. Now, don't abuse strength, don't abuse flexibility and put yourself in awful situations and try and use those attributes to get out of it. But that, with proper technique, is gonna help make you more resilient and less likely to get injured. Next one is one that I definitely need to be working on. That's just proper nutrition and hydration. Like, the most important part of that is going to be mental clarity, because when you get super exhausted, you start to make dumb decisions and you start to not react, and whether it's reacting late to things or even posting kind of lazily in a dumb way that ends up putting you in a position where then you pop your shoulder in a weird direction or your knee isn't quite in the right placement for to drive the right force vector to be able to absorb that force, and your body can generate a lot of force from compromised positions. And so when you start doing this stuff wrong, when you start doing movements incorrect in poor alignment, you're more likely to get injured. And so proper hydration and proper nutrition is gonna help you with stuff like strength training. It's gonna help you with better endurance. It's gonna help you with mental clarity. And so with that as well, when you start to get super tired, a common joke within jiu-jitsu is, hey, one more round, and then that's the round people get hurt. Now, we wanna push ourselves, and especially when we're getting ready for competition training, we need to really push ourselves. We need to break ourselves down. We need to develop that physical strength, that endurance, and that mental strength. But there's times and places for that, and it can be done smart, but we wanna be careful that sometimes when you're just that tired, when you're just that, whether it's from exhaustion from training or whether it's from exhaustion from lack of sleep or just not eating or drinking anything proper, that sometimes you want to be careful about what your training volume is that day or at all, because you might make dumb decisions and you might end up getting hurt. When you are physically exhausted, you are more likely to get injured. And so there are times where, especially with night shift and corrections, sometimes the next day I don't feel like I got enough sleep and I'll skip training that day. I try not to do that a lot, but there's some times where I'm just like, you know what? I don't know how much I'm gonna be able to retain anyway from a learning perspective, but I'm gonna potentially get hurt. Or I go in and I try and do something like, for me, if I'm just wearing my regular t-shirt, that's usually my indicator of me trying to be rolling lighter. And it's also supposed to hopefully be a bit of an indicator to the people I'm training with, where it's like, oh, Rory's just wearing like a regular t-shirt. He's coming in just to do some light drilling, not rolling, because the shirt's gonna get caught on clothing and it's unsafe for both of us. So that's just one of my things where it's like, okay, I'm coming in, I'm just gonna drill today, and I gotta be disciplined with that. And as much as I wanna jump in and I wanna roll, I can't do that because that's going to potentially get me injured. And so if you do go in on those times, try and be very self-aware of how you're feeling and try and be very disciplined. And even have that conversation with your coach afterwards, like, hey, or before class even, and say, you know what, I am not feeling good right now, and just because of lack of sleep, and I just wanna make sure I get some good training in, but I'm not gonna be here for sparring. I don't know a single instructor that would have a problem with that, because we wanna see you on the mats getting better. And the fact that you made sure to come out there, not if you're feeling sick, but you made sure to come out there even though you're not feeling that great, that shows some dedication, some mental strength, good for you. And the last tip is not gonna make some people happy, but no takedowns when you're first learning Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Takedowns are more dangerous because you have uncontrolled momentum of human bodies and people falling. And with that, less control and more likely to get injured. The good thing about whether it's the midget wrestling starting on your knees, which I'm not a fan of, or at least having somebody standing or kneeling guard passing and one person starting playing a guard, is that we have lowered everybody to the ground, or at least the one person's on the ground. It's very unlikely, or at least more unlikely, that you're gonna get injured by being swept from falling from your feet in a more controlled manner to your butt or to your back. And especially as a person on bottom, you're not falling at all at that point. When we're both standing, there's gonna be a much greater fall from a higher height. And that is where people will post their arms on the wrong way. They will post their legs on the wrong way. There are times where I've been training in sweat standing and I have slipped out and strained my groin just because I basically got forced to do the splits. And that could have been done so much worse if I had slipped out even worse, or if somebody was trying to take me down the same way, because as soon as you have someone who weighs anywhere from 100 pounds to 300 pounds working with you and that person starts falling with you, the amount of momentum that starts to get generated by two bodies falling is insane. And that is going to really hurt you if you don't know how to fall properly. So learn your break falls, and then also get comfortable with throws, because depending on the kind of takedowns you're doing, whether it's just traditional kind of wrestling or Greco-Roman wrestling or judo, the different throws and takedowns are gonna have you falling in different ways. And you can have your side break falls and your front break fall and your back break fall trained, but if a throw hits you in a different way and throws you in a direction that you're not quite used to, or that you feel is hard to predict because of your unfamiliarity with that throw, then you might land wrong. One of my old training partners, Shane, was a judo black belt. He was training judo, I think, at like 4 years old, and it was incredible. And with those gi grips, like, I know how to do a side break fall when I'm getting thrown with like just typical hip throw a goshi, but there would be times where like he has a grip and he's doing like a feint and then changing direction so fast and switching into something like a fireman's carry or some complicated throw that ends up launching me in the air, that midway in the air, I'm trying to figure out, like, am I brake falling on my right side or my left side? And sometimes I'm just tucking my arms in and just hoping everything is going to go well, just trying to keep my chin tucked in. And I just got to be really careful with that stuff. And that was me being unfamiliar and being unable to prevent these throws or even knowing what the throw was that was being done to me. And so fortunately, I was very comfortable getting thrown a lot. So I was able to at least, like, I never landed straight on my head, but I wasn't doing anything like posting my arms out. And that's the big mistakes that beginners make. And doing certain takedowns, like, obviously don't jump close guard, because you're basically hurling your body at somebody's hips and knees. And we see catastrophic injuries from that. Jumping scissor takedowns, you can do those things when someone's much more comfortable and you're training with somebody that knows what they're doing. So when we have two purple belts that have hopefully trained takedowns, but even then, sometimes you got purple belts and brown belts that haven't trained much for takedowns. They gotta start slow, drill the techniques, then slowly, even positionally spar stuff where it's like, hey, we're gonna start in a single leg where you've already picked my leg up. And then that person's gonna be trying to run the pipe and trying to do different kind of takedowns from there. And at that point, it's easy for that person to predict, like, well, I'm caught in a single leg. I'm probably either gonna get finished with a single leg in some way, get my back taken, or they're gonna do a double leg variation add on to that of some kind. And so it makes it a little bit easier to predict. Takedowns are very important, but they are more risky. Even for me, I've really been taking takedowns a lot more seriously in the last year, especially during this pandemic. And I still find that I am getting injured more often in the sense of tweaking my knee or tweaking my ankle and stuff like that, because it is a much more explosive game and there are much more risks that can happen, as I said, with that momentum, with that falling, that ends up tweaking my neck or my back or my shoulder in a way, because I'm getting thrown over and over again, even just from drilling, or especially when something happens in a sparring situation. I hope you found those tips useful. The goal is to try and do all those the best we can. I know for myself, I'm gonna work on my own nutrition and hydration, making sure I'm drinking enough water before training as well as during training, because I don't ever do that. I'll show up with a McDonald's coffee and just jump right into it. So understand, it's a combative sport. With that resistance, you are gonna get so much better, but you are gonna potentially get injured. But jiu-jitsu is a blast, and I have to recommend that you try Brazilian jiu-jitsu if you're just like on the fence and you're not sure if you wanna do it. Or obviously if you've been injured and you're a little bit hesitant to get back on the mats, do it. You can do so safely. You can control your training. You can control your partners. You can control yourself. You'll be able to do it and minimize your chance of injuries. We're all gonna die one day, and I'm not interested in tiptoeing through life just to arrive safely at death's doorstep. So get out there, get better at jiu-jitsu, challenge yourself, and you're gonna have a blast.